Hi, my name's John and welcome to another edition of History Roadshow. In today's video, our Tudor tales continue on the reign of Henry VIII. It's at this point that he still seems quite content with his queen, Anne Boleyn, even though no male heir has yet been provided. But things are about to take a nasty turn for the couple. Please subscribe to the channel, hit the bell icon to select all notifications so you never miss any of our videos. And with that said, let's begin today's story. In early February, Henry left Greenwich for Shrovetide celebrations at York Place. His queen and Jane Seymour remained behind until the 24th of February, when Anne joined Henry. Chapuis had said that the king had been sufficiently moved by Anne's distress over his affair with Jane that he would forsake Jane's company on this occasion. Edward Seymour was appointed a member of the Privy Chamber on the 3rd of March. It was a time when both himself and his brother Thomas would be rejoicing, especially as their sister was now at the call of the king. It had been claimed that the Seymours and their allies were hell-bent on bringing down Anne, and Jane would be their foil in which they hoped to cut through the king's defences. This timid act had been used before when Anne Boleyn played a role in her courting of Henry. Later in March, Henry would send Jane a gift of a letter and a purse filled with gold sovereigns, but Jane, who kissed the letter, returned it to the messenger, saying she could only receive such a dowry from the king when she found a husband. Henry was impressed. This was a virtuous lady, and he liked what he saw. But the secret of Jane was out and about. Cromwell told Chapuis that, although the king had been rather fond of the ladies, he would now be more chastely and not change again. But Chapuis knew of the love affair and thought Jane could well be just another in the king's long line of mistresses. On the other hand, Henry still had much affection for his queen at this time, and he had no intention of removing her, to the point that when it came to the Imperial Alliance, Henry would be very defensive of Anne and her position. Anne continued to enjoy life again, and everything seemed to be going well. Her husband was acting more like a husband now, and their differences seemed settled. Anne would go on a spending spree for clothes for herself and her daughter, now 2 years old. Fabrics and trimmings came pouring in: purple cloth with gold, black velvet, satin and silks. Anne would spend around £40 a month on the fittings. Today, the same would cost you about £18,000. The Emperor needed to make a deal with Henry, even to the point of being conciliatory with the offer. He was willing to offer Henry support for the continuation of his marriage, in return for Catherine's daughter, Mary, being declared legitimate. Cromwell was convinced this needed to be done, and even vital to the country's security. Cromwell was never really out of the news, and later in the same month, himself and Anne had a falling out, mainly due to him giving up his rooms to the Seymours. Anne not only hated Cromwell, but wanted him executed. But Cromwell asked Chapuis how would Emperor Charles feel if the king remarried. Chapuis said, "The world will never recognise Anne as Henry's true wife. However, they may accept another lady." Chapuis proved to be coy in his dealings with the queen. He was once given the rare invite to kiss the queen on her cheek, but he somehow managed to steer clear. Anne was bemused by his actions and wanted to know why, and hoped to speak with the ambassador, but he failed to show. Henry told Anne that it is not without good reason. Henry wanted the emperor's apologies and to formally acknowledge Anne as queen in writing. Cromwell knew the emperor would never agree to this. After speaking with Henry about his concerns, Henry roared as only Henry could. Cromwell took the opinion that he should hide away for a while and feign illness. But Cromwell's break from the court didn't result in idleness, and he had started to plan and plot the downfall of the Queen of England. He knew his best chance of survival was to support Jane Seymour, and Chapuis also followed with the approval of the Lady Mary. Anne queried the ongoings within her rooms, and in particular, Madge Shelton. She spoke with Francis Weston, asking why Sir Henry Norris had not yet married her. The resulting conversation would come back to haunt Anne. Weston said Norris comes to your chamber for your grace than he does for Madge. Anne ignored this, but later asked Weston, "Is he in love with his wife?" Weston replied, "He loves one in your household better than both." "And who is that?" said Anne. "It is yourself." Anne at this point stopped the conversation, yet this trivial play on words would later become the backbone of a case, against the Queen. It's unlikely Henry knew anything of the attempt to bring down Anne. At the time, he was gaining joy that the Queen may be pregnant again. On the 25th of April, Henry sent a letter to Rome and others at court, announcing the likelihood and appearance that God may be sending us male heirs. Whether the pregnancy was accurate or not, Henry needed to show the world he could produce heirs and that his marriage was solid to Anne. But this news was bad for Cromwell and caused much alarm amongst the scheming factions, and only the most damning charges against her would now bring her down. On the 29th of April, another conversation was recorded, this time with Mark Smeaton, the Queen's musician. Anne came across Mark looking a little dejected. She said, "Master Smeaton, why are you so sad?" He replied, "It is no matter." But Anne retorted, "You would not have me speak with you as I would a nobleman, because you'd be an inferior person." But Mark replied to his detriment, "No, no, a look sufficeth me." The following day, the Queen watched a dogfight in Greenwich Park. Cromwell would lay evidence at the King's table, stating that Anne had seduced Smeaton and others in the Privy Chamber, including her brother. The so-called evidence seemed beyond reproach and brought enough doubt into Henry's mind that further investigation was needed. Cromwell continued that the Queen was plotting to kill the King, marry one of her lovers, and bring a child into the world that would succeed to the throne.
Most historians believe none of the texts from Cromwell was truthful. It is improbable she would have schemed to murder the King, who, after all, was her chief defender and protector. Today we would call this type of injustice as being framed, and even Chapuis agreed much of the documentation was false. Anne herself would deny any of the rumours right up until the end. However, Anne's reputation and flirtatious nature were now on the line, and many believed she was guilty as charged.
The Queen was now destined to be convicted. Typically, her pregnancy would have saved her, but her child would not have been allowed to live due to the King not wanting a disputed succession. But also, Henry could not be seen as a king who would kill an innocent baby. No other records exist of her pregnancy. On the 30th of April, the chamber was in meeting all day. Crowds gathered at the palace, realising something significant was being discussed. That same day, Anne confronted Sir Henry Norris about his obligation to Madge Shelton. Norris said that he wished to wait a while, but Anne misinterpreted his message and said, "You look for dead man's shoes, for if aught came to the King but good, you would look to have me." Norris was taken aback by her comment and quickly said, "If he ever thought such a thing, he would his head were off." Both noticed others listening to their conversation, and Anne sent Norris away.
11 p.m. that evening, Anne learned that Mark Smeaton had been arrested and taken to the Tower. Smeaton eventually confessed to three occasions when he had committed adultery with the Queen in 1535. He was the only man to accept guilt out of those others arrested, and Anne was now doomed. This arrest and others only confirmed the theories were going around court and the country, and the public didn't need fans to fire the flames on this occasion.
Henry was very close friends with Norris, but he sided with Cromwell and agreed to the charges. Norris was arrested after Henry had approached him, accusing him of adultery with the Queen, dating back to 1533. Norris argued against it, but was swiftly removed and taken to the Tower. Anne didn't have to wait long to find out the breaking news. She was arrested and taken to the Tower on the 2nd of May. Guards also brought her brother, Lord Rochford, to the Tower as a prisoner. The charges of incest were the worst that could have been thrown at Anne. It was considered a vilest accusation, of which there was little to come back from after the announcement.
The once hoped for pregnancy and child were thrown at Rochford, declaring it could not be the King's after all. Lady Rochford was the one who reported this information and that there was indeed undue familiarity between her husband and his sister. It has been said that Lady Rochford's outburst was motivated by jealousy and envy of her husband's friendship with the Queen. And enough was enough for Henry now. That night he broke down. His hopes and aspirations had once again been blown away. He said both he and his sister Mary were greatly bound to God for having escaped the cursed hands of that accursed whore who had determined to poison them.
Many forget Henry at the time was struggling. His only son Richmond was dying, which probably accounted for his temper and emotional rationale. It possibly fell to Jane Seymour to offer a calming influence and a sympathetic viewpoint to a now downtrodden king. On the 17th of May, the alleged lovers of Anne were all executed on Tower Hill.
All except Smeaton stressed their innocence to the end. The same day, Cranmer declared the marriage of Anne and Henry to be null and void, and her daughter Elizabeth was declared a bastard. On Friday the 19th of May, Anne walked to her death, and even Cranmer was impressed with her dignity and courage. Anne Boleyn was executed by the sword at 9 a.m. before being buried at the Chapel of St. Peter within the tower later that day.
There had never been a precedent for a trial or execution of a queen, and this latest act was simply the most sensational story of the era. At one stroke, Cromwell had managed to eliminate a whole family. Elizabeth would reside at Hunsdon when her mother died, and there are no official records of when Elizabeth was told of her mother's demise. Anne's father escaped the axe, but his privileged position in court would end, and when his wife died in April 1538, talk emerged he might marry Lady Margaret Douglas. But this wasn't to be, and he passed away, his burial at Hever Castle, the following year. Lady Rochford retired from court, and her husband's possessions were taken away, and she had to beg Cromwell for financial help.
Cranmer had a close relationship with the Boleyns and survived the suppression. He would continue to promote the reform. Norfolk, who presided over the court case, retained his post as Lord Treasurer. But the Seymours were on the up, and this started the bitter feud between both families. Cromwell continued in the same vein. He had job opportunities and made sure this time the men proposed for such jobs were men who were on his wavelength. There would be no more double guessing at a person's patronage.
Anne Boleyn was one of the most powerful women to ever grace England, to the point of wearing the consort's crown. However, her rapid decline and the catastrophic end showed just how fragile the balance of power was at the English court. So was Anne guilty of nothing more than being in the right place at the wrong time? Over the years, much has been said about her, some quite rightly correct and others with a creative license. The fascination for the Queen will live on in the memory, and whether she was driven by scheming relatives or the possibility that she may actually marry the King, her virtue cannot be questioned. She held out as long as possible, and even then, one last condemnation meant her name was literally chiselled out of the palaces and history books for the rest of Henry's reign.